Over to Texas now, where millions are still without power. One interesting take on this ongoing crisis is the fact that when the state faced its last deep freeze nearly a decade ago, federal regulators recommended that utilities use more insulation, heat pipes, and essentially winterize plants. So what happened to those recommendations that could have helped battle the frigid cold? Joining me now from Washington is Bloomberg Energy and Environment Policy reporter Jennifer DeLuey. Jennifer, thanks so much for being back with us. Take us back to 2011. What happened in Texas?
Right. You saw essentially a preview of what we've seen over the last 4 days in 2011. A cold snap hit the state and it hit New Mexico the very first week of February, putting temperatures below freezing across the state. And rolling blackouts occurred. You saw 4 million people at peak over the course of the event without power. Afterward, federal regulators came in and said, there were some serious challenges here that you're doomed to see, a repeat of this disaster, really, if you don't take care of them. And that's, essentially, as you said, it's winterizing plants, hardening them for these rare but potentially very devastating cold snaps.
Okay, so, I mean, we know what happened. They didn't take care of it, right? They didn't make those
right.
recommendations. Why did those recommendations go unheeded?
So we should say that, by the way, this it didn't happen just in 2011. They were also warned after a similar event in 1989 that spurred the first rolling blackouts in the state. Some of the recommendations were heeded. You saw state lawmakers in 2011 pass a law that allowed the state's regulators to require winterization plans to be updated by power plants. But not much more was done after that, it seems, and power plants were essentially left to their own devices in terms of weatherization. ERCOT, the state's grid operator, has set guidelines after 2011 requiring encouraging winterization, but they'd have no power to mandate these changes or penalize power plants that don't comply. That's something that was recommended in the 2011 analysis of what happened, and it's something we could see materialize again.
Okay, so we do keep hearing about this in the context of a black swan event, a once in a century storm. But it sounds like, based on your reporting, what is happening right now isn't all that surprising given what happened in the 1980s and what happened in 2011.
Right, and we don't know if a climate change will actually exacerbate some of these conditions given what's happening with the jet stream. You know, ERCOT, the grid operator, said that companies have a financial incentive to operate in these demand spikes when prices climb, which is true. But as long as power generators and participants in this market believe these are relatively rare events, these winterization efforts are essentially viewed as kind of insurance against some very rare black swan event. If it's happening once a decade, it still may not be financially beneficial to make these investments.
Wow. So even after a storm such as this, where millions of people have been without power for days, and we see reports of pipes bursting, water quality is bad in Austin and other areas, including Houston, leading to recommendations from officials to boil their water, people are cold. Does anything happen after this?
You know, certainly we're already seeing a lot of finger pointing. We're seeing a number of investigations have already been announced or are coming. There are probes across the board, and we can expect some changes after this. The big question is how many and what mandates might actually come. Former Texas Governor Rick Perry came out yesterday essentially saying that Texans prize their current market structure, which of course incentivizes power plants to bring the cheapest energy to market. So there are gonna be forces against additional mandates as well, and that's gonna play out as these investigations do.
Are there conversations about other states' energy grids now that we've seen what's happened in Texas? Are there conversations happening about other steps that other states need to make?
You know, it's still early days, but one thing that this is already forcing is a broader conversation about the best market structure. And frankly, it's vacillated over decades. Do you go with an independent, deregulated electricity grid like Texas has, or more regulated structure? Those conversations are happening now. You know, Texas's structure has some benefits. It obviously helps incentivize the cheapest energy, but that kind of pricing model, you know, that deregulation and competitive electricity market also acts to disincentivize long-term investments that may be difficult to recoup, whether it's in, you know, power lines or rather infrastructure or winterization, simply warming your instruments and your pipes for events like this.
Bloomberg's Jennifer DeLuey. Jennifer, thank you, as always, for your time. We appreciate you joining us today.
The biggest stories, the moment they happen from around the globe. Subscribe to Bloomberg Quick Take now for insight in an instant.